answers to your gardening questions with the help of Sandy McDonald
on AM 800's Get Gardening.
I'd like to be.
Well, good morning and welcome to Get Gardening, live and local, 519-792-2559. If you want to text in a question or call in, we did just miss a birthday. So before we get into Get Gardening, a happy 68th birthday to Louis Mataltal. That is for tomorrow. That's from your big brother, Louis. So happy 68th birthday to you. Get Gardening brought to you by Plantscape Windsor. Love your space. Again, 519-792-2559. Joining us this morning is Sandy McDonald. Sandy, how are you?
Good. How are you doing there,
Kyle? Yeah, I'm doing all right. Looks like it's going to be a little wet this week. A lot of rain.
I think it's kind of on its way. We sort of expected that we would get some rain eventually this fall. But as gardeners, we actually need some rain in the ground.
Okay.
The soil has actually been rather dry this fall, and we want all of our woody plants especially to go into the winter with plenty of moisture in the roots and the stems and the trunk. That's important. So sorry about the rain, everybody, but I think we're going to have to have a bit for good overwintering of our plants.
All right. I mean, at least it's not supposed to be super cold, right? So, you know, I'll take the rain as long as it's not really cold. 519-792-2559. Busy right off the bat, so let's get into it. This one from Bonnie. Kyle, we have a 4-foot-tall butterfly bush. Do you prune this in the fall? Having issues with it overwintering, bearing strawberries. We have them in 10 deep and 18 across a circular. Well, this one's tough to read. I'm sorry. and they're asking how do you overwinter it as well. They put straw on the plants in previous years, but perhaps left them too long as the leaves were brown and most of the plants died off. Of course, just looked a few days ago and the plant set out some flowers. Too little, too late for berries now. Did that make sense?
A couple things. Yeah.
Okay.
I think I got it.
All right.
So for a butterfly bush, it sometimes doesn't always overwinter that well.
Okay.
One thing is it likes good drainage. So if you have a really heavy, sticky sort of clay soil, it can be a problem getting those through the winter. So basically that's maybe planting them up on a mound or mixing in some sand and some perlite and trying to get them a little bit above ground level. But I wouldn't really transplant them this time of the year because that also can affect their overwintering. So as far as cutting back, I don't cut them back super hard in the fall. Try to just go back a bit in the fall so that the top of the plant isn't moving around all winter through, you know, the winter winds. So if you want to cut it back, up to your knee, you know, a couple of feet or even to, if one of the tall types, even to a meter, 2 or 3 feet, cut off all the long stuff is just fine. Wait until the spring to do any additional pruning. They can be a little bit slow to come out into leaf. So look into, even sometimes it's mid-May, sometimes even a little later in May, look for the new shoots to come up, and that'll be a good indicator as to where you can cut back to for burning bush. A good sunny location, also really important. They don't do well in shade. So a couple points for that. As for the strawberries, I was kind of getting the gist that maybe it was in a type of sort of semi-raised planter. It sounded like it was a circular pattern.
Yeah,
like that.
That's what it says, yep.
Yeah, there's a number of those that have been on the market for a while, and sometimes it's sort of a tiered planter where you have, I don't know, almost looks like a multi-layered cake or something like that.
Okay.
And sometimes those roots on the top part can sort of be exposed to more freezing and thawing. Strawberries are actually pretty winter hardy, so the use of that straw around them is a good idea, but I wouldn't really put it on too early, nor, as they sort of say, leave it on too late. So I have not put anything around my strawberries as of yet, other than the leaves that have blown in there from trees. So I would say wait until we get several really good hard frosts. And we've only had a few light frosts so far. After a really good hard frost, then you can tuck some of that straw in there. As for the flowering late like that, it's true. The everbearing ones, I have some white flowers on mine as well. And also at the college, we have a few white flowers on ours, but it will be too late for those to develop into fruit. So if you like, you can pinch off those flowers because nothing will really happen to them. And I guess we could say that's putting a little bit more energy into the plant. But even if you don't remove those, that'll be perfectly fine to leave them there. They'll just sort of wither away and no berries will develop until next spring.
You brought back some scary memories when you talked about the leaves.
Uh-oh.
15 bags on Monday, and I probably can do another 15 now. That's not even comparing to some people that I saw on Facebook, like with 30, 40, even one person had 50 bags of leaves. So
It's true, but yeah. Then we got to do something with the leaves. We enjoy those trees all summer long for the cooling effect and how beautiful everything is. And
true.
In the fall, if you can't deal with all those leaves on your property, they go to the city and they're going to be turned into compost. So.
Yeah, Kay Cook and I were talking about how we planted as many as we could, because you joined me when I was filling in for Dan, and we were talking about all the leaves out there, and you said, you know, plant them, right? You can actually put them in your garden, and it'll help out. We did as many as we could, and eventually we just ran out of room for them.
Yeah, super helpful, and again, we add extra to our compost pile. We dig some in for new beds and planters and things we can possibly do, but you are right. Even if we chop them down with the mulching mower, sometimes it's just there's too many, and whether it's our tree or a neighbor's tree, they're going to blow around and it'll be on your property.
519-792-2559. Phone lines are packed, so let's head over to them. Let's start off with Greg. Good morning, Greg. How are you?
Well, I'm very good.
Good. What's your question for Sandy?
I have a silver maple about 30 feet in front of my house. Huge roots are near the surface and they're coming towards my house, and I'm concerned with my footing or my foundation getting cracked. If I did a narrow trench from one end of the corner of the house to the other, right across, and cut those roots, how bad would it affect my tree?
Right. Well, the one good thing, I guess, about silver maples is they are very tough. So they're very strong, and there are lots of circumstances where, say, we put in a driveway or a walkway or we're doing some sort of work around the house, and silver maple roots do get cut, and it's unlikely that it would kill the tree. So I'm not expecting that would be a big issue, but you are right. Silver maple, just 30 feet from the house, there are concerns there. They do have very strong roots. The roots are rather shallow, especially on heavier clay soils, and they do go wherever there's moisture. So I would be a little concerned as well. As the tree becomes larger, it's likely that the roots
will... It's completely mature right now. Sorry to interrupt there. Completely mature right now, and that's why I'm so concerned.
Yeah, I almost think, you know, this is somewhere between horticulture and another trade. I would almost have an expert come in and take a look at your foundation as well, because a lot of it is going to depend on the stability of the foundation, how old the house is, what the foundation type is as well. So I'd also seek a little bit of that advice, but the digging of the trench, that is something that can be done. I would probably come quite far out from the foundation. I wouldn't get anywhere near the foundation to do that. But one thing that will happen is those roots will grow back pretty quickly. The roots are going to seek wherever there is moisture, and they will probably grow back even if we do sever some roots at this time. And again, that would be quite a big task, I think.
Okay. Thank you very much.
So, wish I could give you a little bit more help on that one, but it's a great warning to everybody, too, for, I think especially for silver maples. They're very fast growing. They give us quick shade, but as they age, roots are going to go all over, and also as they become quite old, a lot of the upper branches can become rather weak. So it is not certainly not my first choice for a shade tree for a residential yard.
Hmm. Good luck, Greg. Go ahead.
I'm sorry. So if the tree does show signs that it affected it with cutting the roots, will it eventually come back once the roots establish themselves again?
It probably will. Now, there are some dangers as well with a lot of root cutting. You know, there are various root diseases and things like that. But
sure.
Silver maple is so strong that typically the roots come back rapidly. Even when we put in something like, you know, driveway sidewalks as well, where we cut a very long section, those roots generally come back quickly. It could slow the growth of the tree somewhat, but because silver maple is pretty vigorous, I would think you probably wouldn't see much damage to the tree itself, because you're really only cutting along one plane. It's not like you're going all the way around the tree. So all the other sort of, you know, 75% of the tree roots would remain not being cut. So it will take advantage of that area that is undisturbed.
Well, thank you very much.
Good luck, Greg.
Have a great day.
Yeah, you too. Appreciate the phone call. Let's continue on the phone lines with Manuel. Manuel, how are you this morning?
Oh, fine, thank you.
Good.
Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Sandy, the question is, not only me, but everybody. When is the first frost coming so we can pull out all the plants from the ground? I have 21 hostas.
You know.
And some flowers around the donut. Go ahead.
That's a really good question. And, you know, I think I'm kind of like you. I think that, oh, every week we're going to have that, oh, that heavy killing frost. Every week we're going to have that. But we've just had really light ones so far, so I'm trying to enjoy it.
Mm-hmm.
And I've even kept a few plants outside way past when I should. I'm just throwing a little tarp over them when I think it's a really cold night. So we're going to wait for our hostas, for that foliage to die back completely. And I'm the type, too, where, especially now with hostas, there is Hosta X virus plus a couple of other viruses. So I try actually not to cut mine back, because if that virus does come along, by me cutting back the green foliage, I can sort of spread it from one plant to the next to the next. So I actually wait till, just as you say, we get a really hard frost, and all the leaves kind of turn brown. And if that happens, you can almost just grab them with your hand and just pull them away. So I'm waiting. Oh, I shouldn't say this, but well, we're going to have that hard frost anyway. So I'm going to wait.
Can I do it in the spring? Can I pull them out in the spring?
Oh, so for transplanting?
No, pulling them out when they are brown after frost. Can I leave them for the spring, pull them out?
You
can always do it now after the frost.
Sure, you could do that. I think what usually happens with most of the hosta leaves is in the winter, they're probably going to sort of mostly shrivel up, and a lot of them will blow away as well. So there might be a little bit of debris left in the spring, and maybe some of those flowering stalks will be left in the spring as well. So either when they're completely dead and brown, pull them away. If you leave them to spring, it would be no harm to the plant.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Manuel. Take care.
Thanks. Bye. You're good.
I'm not a fan of his question, though. I really enjoyed the fall. You know, I've enjoyed not having frost. I think it's been a great fall. I love you, Manuel, but I don't think we need to be talking about frost right now.
It's been amazing. It's been an amazing fall. So it's true. Some of these tasks and things we want to do when the cool weather comes in, but really we've had great opportunities for moving around our plants, for doing fall fertilizing, all these things. We've had some beautiful days interspersed. We know it's coming. We won't push it this fall.
Yeah, I'm with you on that one. So let's continue on the phone lines here with Rob. Good morning, Rob. How are you?
I'm good.
Good.
I've got a maple tree. It's about 4 feet tall, and it's in a 10-gallon pot. And I want to transplant it to a 30-gallon pot for portable shade. I'm wondering if it's best to do it now or the spring, or does it really matter?
Mm-hmm. Well, either could be done. Does it get winter protection? Do you put it in the ground or in a protected site or...
Well, I can tuck it in the corner in front of my house or whatever.
Yeah, it's most maples, they're pretty root winter hardy, so we're not too worried about that. In severe winter, sometimes we get damage to the roots. The top of the plant is hardier than the roots, so I always keep that in mind. But you could, do you think it's quite tight in the pot now? It's just 4 feet tall.
Yeah, like I'd put it this way, I've had it in this pot for 4 years.
So
it's been survived through all the weather for 4 years now, so and it is pretty tight in there.
Excellent. That's a good point then. So really, we often would say to transplant a lot of potted plants in the spring, but there really wouldn't be any concern with moving it up into the next size pot this time of the year. It's basically dormant, or will be dormant very soon, and there is still some root growth, even though it's going to be in a pot, the root growth will be a little bit slower. So it really could be done fall or spring. I just probably wouldn't rip up the root ball too much when I transplant to the next pot. Maybe I would do probably a little bit of inspection first. I'd slip it out of the pot and take a look at see what that root ball is like. If it's wound around and around and around, there's all kinds of roots there around the side and bottom of the pot, I might just pop it back in the pot and let it get through the winter. If it doesn't look like it has a whole series of tangled roots down there, I might move it up to the next size pot. And the reason I say that is because if it's really wound up like that, I'm probably going to want to loosen up some of those roots before I move it into the bigger pot. And if that's the case, I would probably wait to spring to do it. So maybe we can take a look at the root system to see. If it's been in there for 4 years, my guess is there's lots of roots wound around, and I might wait for spring.
Okay, that sounds good. And the other quick question is, I got trumpet vine going along my fence. I live along the lake. Is there some other vine that can use for privacy that's hardy enough to take the lakefront weather?
is the trumpet vine not doing well now? Or?
Oh, it's doing well, but I had one in Windsor and it took over the whole yard. I'm worried about I might get rid of it here and put something else there because I don't want to take over my whole yard.
That's very true, and that's why I wondered about your fleshing, because usually once it gets going, there's no stopping trumpet vines. So there are many other vines that actually can do well, even near the lake. I would probably stay away from ones that keep their foliage in the winter. So usually the lake, near the lakes, you get, you know, constant wind almost all winter long. So evergreen vines probably are not the very best choice. So it also kind of depends on the area that you have. So it is a big long fence area or trellis or a small area?
Yeah, it depends, about 10 feet long.
Oh, 10 feet long. So not really huge. A whole range of choices. I often like even a mixture of vines, too. It's entirely up to the person, but Clematis or Clematis, if you want strong flowers, that's sort of the queen of vines. And even though it looks quite delicate, it will take wind because, again, it is dormant in winter. And most of the Clematis, too, or Clematis, if you prefer that pronunciation, most of them, too, they take pruning really well if you find that it has some dieback. Of course, there are all kinds of honeysuckles as well. We have a number of honeysuckles that also could work in that sort of location when they are completely hardy. On the market now, we have some that are more of a yellowish-toned flower or orange-toned flower, and those are quite vigorous, easy to grow, and there may even be an advantage near the lakes, too, with a good air circulation we usually get. They wouldn't get, you know, sometimes in town in a shaded location, they kind of get some powdery mildew on them. So there's actually a couple there. If it's native vines, things like our native Virginia creeper, again, it's one that we sometimes find along the forest and will be a little bit more natural looking, but a lot of people grow that for the beautiful red fall color. So there's a few suggestions for you. I almost would take a look in the nurseries in the spring and look in the section with vines and sort of select if you want to go something with, you know, fall foliage color, or you want to go something with density of foliage, or you want some flowers in spring or summer. And there's really a wide number of choices that you could choose that would work best for, you know, what you'd like to have in the garden, what you'd like to see.
Yeah, okay, and that mixture sounds good to me, so thank you very
much. Yeah, I sometimes like that. With a mixture, though, try to choose ones that have similar vigor, so try not to put one that's really wild and growing. You've already had trumpet vine, so I probably wouldn't mix trumpet vine with sort of the more delicate growing clematis, because that's probably one's going to take over the other. So if they're all of medium growth or they're all of sort of more slow or moderate growth, those would combine well. Putting a really vigorous one with a slow-growing one, the fog might take over.
Okay, thank you.
All right, Rob, good luck with that. Appreciate the phone call. Again, 519-792-2559. We'll take the first break. We'll come back. We'll get to some of your texts as well. 519-792-2559. Sandy McDonald answering all of your questions. My name is Kyle Horner. This is Live and Local Gig Gardening on AM 800.
Next time on the TED Radio Hour, clinical psychologists John and Julie Gottman are marriage experts. And after studying thousands of couples, they have found
couples who are successful have a really different way of talking to one another when there was a disagreement or a conflict.
How to be brave in our relationships. That's next time on the TED Radio Hour from NPR. TED Radio Hour. Listen Sundays on the iHeartRadio Talk Network.
Rob's Pharmacy, 1765 Sprucewood Ave in LaSalle, providing pharmacy services focused on you and your family. Rob'sPharmacy.com.
Hey, Mid-Hunter Weather, brought to you by 93.9 Virgin Radio, your favorite artist, their biggest hits, music, news, and more. 93.9 Virgin Radio. We haven't moved much this morning. Mainly cloudy with a high 12 or 54. Mainly cloudy tonight. Fog patches developing after midnight. Low plus 4 or 39. Mainly cloudy tomorrow. Fog patches will dissipate tomorrow morning. High 12 or 54. Tomorrow night cloudy periods with a 40% chance of showers. Low plus 5, 41. Monday looks nice. Sunday and sunny and a high of 12 or 54. Tuesday, back to a chance of showers. Cloudy with a 40% chance of showers. High 14, 57. Wednesday, cloudy, 60% chance of showers. High 9 or 48. Thursday, cloudy with a 60% chance of showers. High 6 or 43. And on Friday, cloudy with a 40% chance of showers. High 6 or 43. Not great. Overcast right now, 9. Feels like 8, 46 Fahrenheit.
It's beginning to sound a lot like Christmas with iHeart the Holidays. Non-stop Christmas music, 24-7. All your festive favorites. Unwrap the magic of the season, one song at a time. Ask your smart speaker to play iHeart the Holidays on iHeartRadio. Download the free app today.
If you've always wanted Christmas lights at home, but don't have the ladder or lights to decorate your higher roof line, let the professionals at Plantscape Windsor help. Their design team can create a plan for indoor or outdoor holiday decorations. Garland, trees, festive arrangements are available too. They have customized packages starting at only $750 for your residential or commercial needs. Call Plantscape Windsor today, 519-972-5440. Online at plantscapewindsor.ca.
If you're an entrepreneur, growth is essential for your business. And at BDC, we get that. That's why we offer strategic advice and flexible financing. The results speak for themselves. Businesses that we support grow at double the average rate. Accelerating the pace, we're on it. BDC, financing, advising, know-how.
The Waffle Festival is underway at Cora Breakfast and Lunch.
I'll have the peanut caramel waffle, please.
But with 5 new sweet and savory dishes to choose from, it's also a bit of a waffling festival.
Actually, make it a s'more waffle. Wait, the smoked meat waffle sandwich. No. The peanut caramel waffle.
But once you're done waffling, you'll love the waffle you end up ordering. So stop waffling and head to Cora Breakfast and Lunch. Festival ends January 12th.
Wait, the s'mores waffle?
At Art Windsor Essex, witness transformation through the power of art. Experience thought-provoking artworks by cutting-edge contemporary artists. Engage in community events like Awe at Night, or witness limited-time exhibits like Alejandro Tamayo's At the Moment the Work is Like This, where everyday objects become extraordinary. See the full schedule of exhibits and events at artwindsoressex.ca and visit Art Windsor Essex in the heart of downtown Windsor today. Be inspired. Be in awe.
When daylight savings ends, be ready to light up your life with help from the Lighting Boutique. Save 30% store-wide during the Turning Back the Clock sale. Lamps, lighting fixtures, exterior lighting, fans, and more. Save 30% store-wide. And if you need advice on the right lighting for every room in your home, their professionals are always ready to help. Save 30% during the Turning Back the Clock sale now through November 18th at the Lighting Boutique. Visit lightingforlife.com.
Never miss another moment. AM800 is available anytime, anywhere.
Just connect your device and use the free iHeartRadio app now.
Helping you get to the root of the problem.
Here's Sandy McDonald on AM800's Get Gardening.
Well, good morning and welcome back to Live and Local. Get Gardening, Kyle Hunter with you, Sandy McDonald, answering all of your questions, 519-792-2559. Let's get to some of your text here. Hi, my elephant ears are still outside and they need to come in after I cut off the stalks. Do I just put the bulbs in shredded newspaper and then into a dark basement? Thanks.
That can work for the most case. Again, especially if one of the elephant ears has that large sort of bulbous base on it, those ones store pretty well. But there's lots of other ones where you don't really find that bulb at the base, and so those ones don't store too well. So take a look at that, of course, when you cut the leaves back and you pull it up. Most of the elephant ears have had their leaves damaged by some frost now. So if you find that you have one where there isn't that bulbous base, then yes, please take off some of those damaged leaves from the frost. But if there's still a couple green leaves in the center, those you might want to pot up and keep as a houseplant. So it does depend on the type. Excuse me, a few years ago it was pretty easy. We grew mostly one or two types. Now we have a whole world full of interesting and fascinating elephant ears. So I just want people to make sure they have success. And in the shredded newspaper, that usually usually works as well. Maybe do a little check of that every couple of few weeks or so. Sometimes they run a little bit dry, sometimes they run a little bit moist, and it kind of depends on the storage conditions in your basement. So we don't want it to be too wet and soggy and molding, and again, too, we don't want it to dry out completely where it's shriveling, so keep an eye on them.
519-792-2559. I've been going through this one. I think I have it down. There's a little bit of spelling mistakes. We've had a little bit of that this morning. I'm doing my best here. Good morning, guys. I think it's a pear tree. I have a pear tree more than 7 years, no flowers, no fruits. A couple of weeks ago, I see the top shooting flowers and some pears.
Oh, yeah, it's not a good time for that.
I guess what can the Dexter do? That's about all.
Yeah, it's great that they're finally seeing some flowers on it, but it's kind of the wrong time of the year, right? Even a number of plants now, I was out with students, of course, this week taking a look at various plants, and, you know, we have some lilacs showing a few flowers, and a lot of plants are blooming a little bit out of sync, and again, too, we've had sort of a long extended fall, so this can happen. I wouldn't worry too much about those flowers or those particular little pears that will develop, because the winter is going to take care of those, so they're not going to hold through the winter. But it's good to know that the tree of 7 years now is mature enough that it can produce some flowers and pears on it. So I think that's a positive sign. Now, very hopefully, a lot of the other branches on the tree have developed some flower buds, because the flower buds develop in the summer through late summer. They overwinter and are supposed to bloom in the spring. So the ones that have bloomed now will not produce any pears for the spring. But hopefully they've got dormant buds there and will get flowers in the spring, and hopefully they get the fruit there thereafter as well.
Morning, guys. I have a lilac that I need to trim back. It's about 2 feet into the tree and has sprouts where it has the leaves and blooms. Past that, it's bare. Will it resprout new growth in the spring?
So, yeah, there are a couple of things there. So the good part is that lilacs take pruning really, really well. I guess the more unfortunate part is if you have to do a lot of pruning right now, you will sacrifice the flowers in the spring. Kind of like the pear that we discussed there, the flowers develop in the summer, late summer, fall. They overwinter, and then that's what gives us the spring blooms. If it's really all tangled at this time or is way out of size and you do want to deal with it right now and you don't worry about losing the flowers in spring, you can certainly go ahead and prune it this time. If you really want those flowers and you'd rather deal with this after blooming time, that's the perfect time to prune lilacs right after flowering. So either way is fine. It's just a matter of whether you want to sacrifice the flowers or not. Prune it back to shape is perfectly fine. Our general rule of thumb is to say not go back more than one-third of the total amount of length of stems on the plant. But lilacs are tough. If you go back much further than that, they will still be fine. They're very rare that we would kill one through pruning. And very often you can reduce them down to knee-high or so, and they will sprout back from that as well. Just not flowers for the first season.
Okay, here we go with Kyle trying to pronounce a word again. When is the latest time to move a tree, a weeping variegated Japanese willow? Variegated Japanese willow?
Oh, that's good.
Okay.
Yeah, we've got it there.
Sorry, it took two tries, but we got it.
So not an issue there. So the willows, again, most of them, even the sort of the fancier variegated types, and this would be one that typically has a little bit of pink and some white and green in the foliage, they're pretty hardy. So you could actually transplant even still. That would be fine. They start into growth really quite early in the spring, so sometimes we miss our opportunity in the spring to move willows before they come into growth. So it would be fine to transplant that now, move it to another location now, and as always, just try to get a good-sized root ball. Even if it's a container as well, you might want to loosen up the roots a little bit if there's lots of tangled roots in there, and tuck it in for now, and then you should get good, strong, vigorous growth in the spring.
Good morning. We never take the hostas for the winter. We leave them in the ground and they come back in the spring. We do that every year. Is that a good move?
So by the message there, I'm wondering, take them out, or I'm not sure. Perhaps
we never take out the hostas for the winter.
Right. Yeah. And that's perfectly fine. So hostas are also, they're hardy herbaceous perennials, meaning that even though all the leaves die back and you don't see anything for the winter there, they are quite fine to come back in the spring. Winter hardy, no issues. We don't have to take them out of the ground. They can be planted in their sort of permit location, should return year after year.
Good morning, Kyle and Sandy. I have a couple questions. We have a dwarf boxwood and a dwarf bobo hydrangea. It's a white-shaped flower. Please let me know when and how to prune each of those. Also, I have a lot of thatch in my grass. It's Kentucky bluegrass. It was sodded about summer 2023. Just wondering if I should dethatch it or what other options do I have. Thank you.
So a couple things there. So in the case of the bobo hydrangea, you can prune that either fall or spring. It will still continue to bloom on the new wood that it develops, so that can certainly be done. The boxwood, we want to be careful there because, of course, we've had the invasion of the box tree moth. So I'm not even thinking about pruning them a whole lot right now, to be honest with you. But if yours is good and healthy, I still think I would have on hand a little bottle of that BTK for the spring so that we don't have further issues. But generally, if your boxwood is healthy, yes, you can prune them. Even this time of year is okay. I'm not going to probably cut it back very, very hard. If you cut back boxwood to sort of bare twigs or bare stems without any green leaves left behind the cut, they don't come back very well from that. But if you want to do a light shearing or pruning right now to give you a nice sort of uniform shape for winter, you can certainly do so. Just keep that BTK around just in case.
Yeah.
There's a few safe boxwoods around, but again, we're concerned about that issue coming back. And so those two taken care of. As for the thatch, it's a little bit unusual to have a thick thatch on a newly sodded lawn like that. So that kind of makes me wonder, I guess, a bit how that thatch built up so quickly. I wouldn't probably go through and try to do thatching at this time of year. This is maybe a good time of year to maybe take a good look at that. I would almost, if you're not sure about it, sort of cut out a little piece of it. Maybe take your spade and cut out, oh, I don't know, a 1 foot square piece or whatever, and then sort of examine it through the side and see, is there really a thick layer of thatch there? Again, we don't want anything, I'm going to say even half the length of your pinky. Once you get sort of 3 centimeters, 2, 3, 4 centimeters, an inch and a half or so of thatch, that's time to start working on it. And that thatch, a thin layer of thatch is perfectly fine. But if you look at soil, and then there's a thick layer of tangled thatch there of that depth, and then the green grass sprouting above it, that's a deeper thatch. We might want to dethatch. However, I'm kind of surprised that that's built up so quickly. Maybe it's just a lot of the dead foliage, dead leaves in there. Maybe just a good raking will pull most of that out. So you can do a little experimentation with that. Get your fan rake out, do a little bit of raking there, and see, oh, yeah, it's really just a bit of dead grass in there. But if that thatch is truly there and quite thick, then in spring, just before we start getting into any good growth, probably in April or so, a dry week, we can do some dethatching, and that will pull out all that extra dead leaf tissue there.
Sandy, I know you've been studying the boxwood moth. Do you expect the same thing we have this year and next year?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Not good news, I would say. I don't really think it's going to go away. Sometimes we think, oh, if they've destroyed all the boxwood, then they'll be gone forever. That didn't happen with emerald ash borer, and that didn't happen with another pest that we've had that are invasive. So I would say to just sort of be ready for it. Some people, they are fighting the fight. They are going to keep their boxwood. They're just going to put that BTK on 3, 4, 5 times through the growing season. And I have seen some beautiful boxwood, and
yeah,
I've seen some that are skeletons.
Yeah.
So you do have a bit of a choice. We just need to monitor early and check our boxwood very carefully once the foliage is sort of, the new foliage has sort of emerged. We've got to keep our eyes ready for that pest. So I think we're going to have problems into the future.
Yeah, well, may the force be with those people that still have boxwood.
Absolutely. Good. Good for you if you can keep your boxwood in great shape.
Let's go over to Doris. Good morning, Doris. How are you?
Oh, hi.
Hi.
Good morning to both of you.
Yeah, morning.
I'll tell you, I have some beautiful chrysanthemums this year. They're still in full bloom, but they've grown, and they're just hanging over. I was concerned about when I should cut them, before the frost, or should I leave them till spring, or...
So you are absolutely right. We've had a great, long, drawn-out fall season. And also, I kind of applaud you, too, for having the later blooming chrysanthemums. A lot of people are getting the ones or buying the ones that are flowering in August, and sometimes they don't last too long. But the later blooming ones, you can enjoy those for a much longer period of time.
Oh, I am. I really am this year.
That is the thing to do. So really, as for cutting them back, even if they're flopping, I kind of just let them go at this stage. Enjoy the flowers. You know, be nice. Maybe we can get a couple more weeks of them. And enjoy that color. Once we get to the point where we've had a couple of very hard frosts and everything is obviously brown, just to provide them from all breaking up, you can kind of cut them back a bit. I say usually about, maybe 20 centimeters, 6 or 8 inches or something from the ground. I like to leave those little stubs there so maybe it'll collect a little bit of leaves. There's a little winter protection around
cover
that.
Cover them, yes.
Yeah. And then that should be fine for the next year.
Okay.
One pointer I can give you, though, if you have some types that are kind of tall and do flop over, next late spring or so, when we get to the end of May into mid-June, if you want to pinch all the tips of them, by that pinching when they're maybe, 8, 10 inches or so tall, that actually causes them to branch out a little bit more. So the plants will be slightly shorter, but they'll have more branches, and they won't be as inclined to sort of flop over. And you just have to do that usually once.
Okay. Now, when is the best time to, if I want to plant some somewhere else in the yard, what would be the best time? Now or in the spring?
The spring is the better time for that.
Okay.
Because I would try to do that just as those new shoots start coming from the ground in the spring.
Okay.
And they're pretty easy to divide at that time of year, and then they have the whole season to grow and develop a good root system, and they overwinter better that way.
Great.
You couldn't transplant them now or divide them now, but we never know the kind of winter we have, and sometimes they sort of heave in the freeze and thaw cycle.
That's right.
Yeah, so spring
you're right.
Best.
Oh, thank you ever so much.
Good luck, Doris. Appreciate the phone call.
Thank you.
All right,
bye.
Take care.
Now have a good day.
Thanks, you too. Let's take that final break. 519-792-2559. We'll come back and get to your final text. It's Sandy McDonald answering all of your questions. My name is Kyle Horner. This is Live and Local Get Gardening on AM 800.
You want to be a lifeguard? This is the real deal.
From the executive producer of The West Wing and Shameless, don't miss a new episode of the thrilling action drama.
Go, go, go!
Rescue High Surf, Monday at 9 on CTV. Stream next day on Crave.
If you've always wanted Christmas lights at home, but don't have the ladder or lights to decorate your higher roof line, let the professionals at Plantscape Windsor help. Their design team can create a plan for indoor or outdoor holiday decorations. Garland, trees, festive arrangements are available too. They have customized packages starting at only $750 for your residential or commercial needs. Call Plantscape Windsor today, 519-972-5440, online at plantscapewindsor.ca.
AM 800 weather brought by Rob's Pharmacy, 1765 Sprucewood Ave in LaSalle, providing pharmacy service focused on you and your family. Visit robspharmacy.com. Mainly cloudy today with a high 12 or 54. Mainly cloudy tonight. Fog patches developing after midnight. Low plus 4 or 39. Sunday, mainly cloudy. Fog patches will dissipate tomorrow morning. Wind will be out of the southwest, 20 kilometers an hour, gusting up to 40. It's a high 12 or 54. And then tomorrow night, cloudy periods with a 40% chance of showers, low plus 5 or 41. Monday, sunny, high 12, 54. Tuesday, cloudy with a 40% chance of showers, high 14, 57. And on Wednesday, cloudy with a 60% chance of showers, high 9, 48. We haven't moved all morning long. It's still overcast out there. It's still 9. Still feels like 8. That is 46 Fahrenheit.
As the weather cools down, things are heating up at Paradise Breakaway and All-Star Bingo and Gaming Centers in Windsor and the Power Play Gaming Center in Lakeshore.
Escape the cold and enjoy the fun inside. Whether you're joining friends or flying solo, there's excitement waiting with bingo games and Vegas-style gaming rooms. Check out book specials, jackpot totals, and session times at we-bingo.com. That's we-bingo.com, where they put the win in Windsor Essex this November. Remember, must be 18 to play and play smart.
This is the sound of an exciting Black Friday sale.
and this is the sound of an exciting Black Friday sale at Sleep Country. Black Friday just isn't the same at Sleep Country, except for the best deals on the best brands. Get hot prices on headboards starting at only $249. Enjoy a free gift with a minimum purchase, and right now, save a tax on everything for a limited time only. Don't miss out. The Black Friday event is on now at Sleep Country. Restrictions apply.
This week at Fred Storm Fresh, crisp California romaine hearts are $2.99. Two bunches of fresh asparagus, only $4. And 5-pound bags of California almonds, only $5.99 a pound. FredStormFresh.com.
Whether it's towing your big toys or hauling gear for the job site, the Toyota Tundra handles it all without breaking a sweat. By the end, you'll be standing there wishing you could high-five that truck. That's what we call being Tundra Struck. It's time to be impressed. It's time to Toyota. Lease a 2024 Tundra 4x4 Crewmax SR from $129 weekly for 40 months at 2.39% with $5,300 down. Visit shoptoyota.ca or your local Ontario Toyota dealer today.
Walmart's Black Friday deals are on now. Shop our lowest prices of the year on hundreds of items. Hurry now and save 55% on Squishmallows or Disney Squishmallows on for only $7.97. That's $10 in savings at Walmart.
You call your trip to the beer store a run for a reason. That cold beer fridge? You're bound to get chilled. So it's better to run in and run out. Beer stays cold, you stay warm. The beer store. It's more than a beer run. Must be 19 plus. Please enjoy responsibly.
Hi, welcome to McDonald's.
Hi, can I get a... Yep. The McValue menu has a lot of delicious options for under $4 each plus tax. So it's okay to take a minute when ordering. The McValue menu. At participating McDonald's restaurants in Canada, prices exclude delivery.
I was pretty sick this year, but plasma donors helped me. I need medications made from plasma so that I can get better when I get sick. I use them every month to treat my immunodeficiency.
To treat my rare blood disorder.
To keep me healthy while I receive cancer treatment.
To prevent infections during my organ transplant.
I know you have a lot on your to-do list, but I have to ask, will you please donate plasma and start a life-saving habit? Visit blood.ca to book a donation appointment at a Canadian Blood Services location near you.
10,000 years before the birth of Paul Atreides, we founded a sisterhood.
Crave presents the next groundbreaking original series from HBO, Dune Prophecy. Streams November 17th, only on Crave. Subscribe now at crave.ca.
They say talking to your plants may help them grow.
You look ravishing.
Oh, you're so grounded.
I'm rooting for you, bud.
If you really want your plants to grow, just talk to Sandy McDonald now on AM 800's Get Gardening.
That's right, Sandy McDonald answering all of your questions. My name is Kyle Horner. This is Get Gardening Live and Local on AM 800 519-792-2559. Here comes a word that I have never heard of again, so help me out here, Sandy. All my roses are still blooming. Where can I plant a marjoram seed, and are they perennials? Marjoram?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Yep.
Okay.
Good, good. So, yeah, we're into somewhere between culinary and horticulture here.
Okay, all right.
So marjoram is an herb plant. And the roses are beautiful this fall. That's a good point.
Yeah.
Actually, this fall's been amazing. All kinds of beautiful things in bloom. So, again, we're going to enjoy all of that for as long as we can. So, as for marjoram, there's two types. One type is basically annual or summer marjoram. And there's another one that actually is winter hardy and is perennial. So, it does depend on the type that you have. I'm not sure if they have the seed already or not. But the perennial one, it's almost treated like oregano would be, and so it is winter hardy in our area. It's kind of like savory as well. That's another herb. The marjorams and savory are rather similar. I'm guessing, though, if they're growing marjoram, it's probably the annual type because that's the type that is more common, and it's actually a bit more aromatic. The leaves are a bit thinner, so easier to use in cooking. So that one, normally we would sow that, plant that in the spring. You can start small seedlings indoors maybe about April or so. You don't have to start too early. Or you could direct sow it outdoors. And we don't need to probably do that right away. It doesn't have to be in, say, March or April. You could do that into mid-May or so, and it grows quite quickly. And you should be able to harvest some, you know, within a month or so. So I'm thinking it's the sweet marjoram, the annual one. So hold on the seeding until indoors for around April or so, or outdoors the middle of May.
Let's do a little rapid fire here because they're coming fast and furious at the end of this show. One here on the elephant ear, which I think we started off the show with. Hi, if an elephant ear bulb gets dry in the shredded newspaper, do I just spray water on the newspaper? Won't that get soggy?
It can get soggy, you're right. Sometimes what I do if that happens, take the bulb structure out and then sort of spritz that, or sometimes if it's really dry, I dip it in water, and then I just let it sit there for the day. And again, a little bit of that moisture will go in, a little bit will evaporate, and then I pop it back into the shredded paper.
Another one here. Good morning, guys. Great show. Listen every week. We appreciate that. Same question as earlier, but it is a 30-year-old oak tree about 25 feet from the house. Will I have a root foundation footing problem in time?
And you're a little safer with oak than with a silver maple. That's one good thing. A lot of the oaks, they often have a tap root. A lot of them try to go quite deeply into the soil. Not too often do they travel across the surface of the soil, so that's kind of a good thing. It's close to the house. Oaks live a long time. I would still, if you're unsure about that, I would still have a professional come in and check your foundation, right? Security of your foundation, the way the foundation is built, the type of it, the age of the house. All those things are important things as well. You're a little safer with oak. I never say never with the way plant roots can grow, but there is a slight advantage we can think about too. On a house that has more of an overhang, that actually will create a dry zone next to the foundation of the house. So that doesn't mean plants directly want to go right against the foundation wall because it's kind of dry. They prefer to be out past the overhang of the house where there is more moisture. So that's always something I keep in the back of my mind, that if you have extra overhang around the house, it's a dry zone. Hopefully the roots will not be a big issue close to the house. But again, in time, if that oak tree lives for 200 or 300 years,
good luck.
Good luck. Yeah.
I like this question. Sandy, I have a coffee plant, 3 feet. It has 3 beans on it. What do I do with the beans?
Oh, that's great. So I'm glad you have 3, but it's going to make a very small cup of coffee.
That's what I was thinking.
Yeah, but it's great. So, you know, if it was me, because I'm the gardener, but I love coffee. It's not going to make a whole cup of coffee, and wait till they turn red? I could sort of then take the red coating off, let them dry a bit. I could roast them. But if I truly want to make my own cup of coffee, I might let them go to red. Afterwards, I would take all the red off. I would let them dry. And then after I dry them, I probably would put them in a little packet of anti-desiccant, seal them in a jar, and put them in my freezer, and I'm going to wait for the next crop. Maybe eventually I get enough beans that I can roast them and make my own coffee. The other option, because I'm a gardener, I might let them go red, and then eventually I'll clean all of that red material off, wash them off, and then I'll probably plant those seeds, and I'm going to get some new coffee plants to give to my friends and relatives.
Okay. I like that idea.
2 choices.
Yeah, I like it. How far back do you trim the dwarf bulbo hydrangea that we were talking about? Do you cut it off just the dead flowers, or trim back the flowers and the wood stems?
Yeah. So that can be kind of up to your choice as well, how big you want the plant to be. And bulbo is a rather small. It's quite a dwarf hydrangea, and it takes pruning well, especially if you've had them for a few years. If they're pretty new plants, if they're, say, 2 or 3 years old, I would just sort of cut the flowers off at this point and let them go for a couple more years. If you've had them for 5, 6, 7 years, you can easily go back and cut them by, say, half, and they will sprout very well after cutting back by half.
Another one here. Can you transplant hostas and a tall grass that has gone rogue before it snows, or should I wait until spring?
The hostas, yes. They can be transplanted nearly any time of year. Even when they're in full leaf, you can transplant them, divide them up a bit. They don't look too nice after that, but you can certainly move your hostas around. I wouldn't make little tiny, tiny divisions of them, but if you need to cut them in half or quarters or something like that and move them around, you can, or move a whole clump in a new location, go right ahead. Tall grasses, depends on the type. There's all kinds of ornamental grasses. Some of them prefer to be moved and divided in the spring. If it's just moving the plant, like a whole plant to a new location, there's probably going to have success with that. If it's a big clump and you're just sort of cutting the whole clump in half and maybe moving half of it to a new location, no real issue with that. If it's If it's one you want to divide up into very small pieces and transplant to other locations, I would probably wait till spring to do that.
Okay, and we'll end with a happy one here. We were talking about, or sorry, you guys were talking about the great fall that we've had. What a fall it is. My spring pansies have decided to bloom again. Have a great day, guys. So there you go.
Wow, yet another advantage, right? Because sometimes in the heat of our summer, things like pansies and violas, they kind of go off blooming. But this fall, beautiful things, beauty berries, chrysanthemums, the fall pansies, all the beautiful fall foliage, all that great stuff. Mm-hmm. We enjoyed it, I think.
With that said, next time we talk, it'll be the last day of November. We'll talk to you in 2 weeks, Andy.
Hopefully great weather still.
I'm hoping. We'll, you know, forget the... Although you said we do need the rain this week, right? So
we do, yeah.
Okay.
We'll get past that.
Yeah, I'll get over it. Thanks again, though, Sandy. I do appreciate it.
Enjoy your weekend.
You too. Take care. There you go. Sandy McDonald answering all of your questions. Of course, Gig Gardening is brought to you by Plantscape Windsor. Love your space. Experts on